Well, good morning, church. This is such a beautiful, beautiful Easter Sunday. And I know there's rain predicted for later today, so the weather might not be beautiful, but the meaning of the day is beautiful because today is the day that we celebrate Christ's resurrection, the day that he conquered death. And this day is so beautiful because it's the foundation of our salvation message. You know, and it's the most important day that we celebrate in Christianity. So I'm so glad to have you with us this morning. And I just want to remind you guys of a couple of things real quick before we jump into the service. Number one, we do have activities for the kids to be doing during this quarantine time. We're releasing two videos a week. Elena has been working really hard on getting all that stuff together and getting the activities together. You can find this information on our website at vineyardlc.org/kids. And you can also find it on our Facebook page if you just search for Vineyard Lake Charles. You can find the videos there, and in the Facebook videos, there's a link to our website where you can find the activities that go along with the videos. So I just want to remind you guys about that, and if you haven't heard about it, just tell you about it for the first time. And I also want to remind you guys, look, I know Alpha is over now, and the classes are finished. You know, this has been all 10 weeks so far, and it was a great class, and I learned a lot. I had a lot of great fellowship with our group, as I'm sure you guys did as well, but I just want to remind you, it doesn't have to stop here. Your Alpha group is your small group. You guys can stay connected throughout this time of quarantine and social distancing, and it's just really a great time to continue to reach out to each other and grow with each other, even though we're so far apart. We have so many ways that we can be doing this through Zoom calls. Facebook Messenger does video calling. Google Duo is another great free way to do video calling. There's just so much that we can do to stay connected, even though we're distant. So guys, I just want to encourage you to continue doing that. And finally, guys, I'm just going to go ahead and pray, and I'll send it over to Don and the worship team. Father, we thank you for your son. We thank you for the willingness that he had to die on the cross and for the authority and the power that he had to raise from the dead and conquer death. We just, Father, we just love that. We thank you for the salvation that you offer us through that, through the conquering of sin, Father. We give our lives back to you, Father. We give our will, our heart, our emotions. We give it all to you, Father. We lay it at your feet. And we just ask that you would fill us up with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not, my Lord was crucified. Knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I'd learned, then I trembled at the law I'd spurned. Till my guilty soul in glory turned to Calvary. There your mercy and your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. I've given Jesus everything. Now I gladly own him as my King. Now my raptured soul can only sing of Calvary. There your mercy and your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied. grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. Yeah. There your mercy and your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. There your mercy and your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied to me.
Again and again.
amazing love that welcomes me. Kindness and mercy that bought with blood, wholeheartedly, my soul undeserving.
The dark tried to hide you and steal you away. Death tried to keep you inside of the grave. The enemy fought you, he tried but he lost. You cannot be stopped. When we cried for freedom, you tore down the walls. The weight of our burdens, you carried it all. Our fears and our failures hang dead on the cross. You cannot be stopped. No mover of mountains, breaker of chains, Jesus is triumph over the grave. Sing hallelujah, the battle is won. Nothing can stand against our God. We stand on your victory, we shout on your praise. O miracle maker, you're mighty to save. Awesome in power, relentless in love. You cannot be stopped. O mover of mountains, breaker of chains, Jesus is triumph over the grave. Sing hallelujah, the battle is won. Nothing can stand against our God. There is nothing that can stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There is nothing. There is nothing. There's nothing that can stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There's nothing. Stop our God. No, there's nothing that can stop our God. Oh, there's nothing that can stop our God. There is nothing. No, mover of mountains, breaker of chains, Jesus is triumph over the grave. Sing hallelujah, the battle is won. Nothing can stand against our God. Your mover of mountains, breaker of chains, Jesus is triumph over the grave. Sing hallelujah, the battle is won. Nothing can stand against our God. Oh, sing hallelujah, the battle is won. Nothing can stand against our God. Thank you. take all of me.
Church, and happy Easter. I pray that God is blessing you and holding you up right now as we celebrate Him together. Yes, we may not be together in person, but we can still worship Him together right now. You know, Easter is an amazing time of the year, and I always think about it like this. Right now, literally right now, today, there are hundreds of millions of people that are all worshiping Jesus for the exact same thing. Regardless of denomination, regardless of divisions in the church, we are all coming together, millions of people on this tiny little planet. We are all celebrating Him for rising from the grave. Look, the churches may be empty. This chapel that I'm speaking in right now may be empty, but so was the grave when he rose from the grave. And that is why he is always worthy of our praise. Look, right now it's easy to panic. It's easy to look around and begin to fear of what is happening in our world. If you watch the news too long, if you pay attention to social media, you can become a person that's fearful and worrying all the time. This morning when my three-year-old came into bed with me, like he usually does, it's usually to say, "Hey, Dad, I'm hungry. Can you fix me something to eat?" Well, today was different. Today he put his head on my shoulder. He looked at me and he said, "Dad, you know God is real, right?" And I love that. Those are kind of reminders that we need every day, that despite everything going on in our world, we need to understand that God is real, that he is in control, that he holds everything in his hands, including what's happening right now. So we have to trust him for it. And that's what we've been talking about over these last couple of weeks. How do we make God our one trust? And usually the way we do that is when we are in seasons of despair, we're in seasons of turmoil. We started off with King David. King David showed us how to do that, how to worship God despite the circumstances around us, that we need to preach to ourselves every day, we need to rest in the promises of God, and we need to trust in God at all times. I hope that you're doing that as I'm doing that every day. And then last week, we learned about Elijah. Elijah was an incredible man, lived an incredible life, but he did not have his small amount of aloneness that he felt. He knew what it was like to be alone. He also knew what it was like to be in despair. He also understood disadvantages, but he didn't wallow in his disadvantages. No, he actually loved disadvantages because he knew that's when God was going to move the greatest. Elijah knew about these things. He was against 450 prophets just by himself. He had a soaked altar with water versus a dry altar that the prophets of Baal had. But he didn't wallow in that. He wasn't scared about that. He didn't have fear. In fact, he knew that God's greatest victory was about to come. And that's exactly what happened. You see that all across the Bible, where Joseph, vice president of Egypt, right before that, he was in a dungeon all by himself. Daniel, before his enemies were defeated, he was in a den of lions by himself. Perhaps the greatest disadvantage that mankind has ever known was when a man was dead and put into a tomb. And then three days later, he rose from the grave in victory. Our God thrives in disadvantages. But Elijah also taught us about prayer, that in despair should come a heart of prayer. And that's exactly what happened. You see, God had promised to Elijah that he would send rain. But the way that he was going to answer that was through the earnest prayer of Elijah. See, God has also made a promise to the church. He says the church will not fall. The church will not fail. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church. And maybe the way that God is looking to answer that promise right now is through the earnest prayer of the saints. So I pray that you are not wasting the season you are in. I pray that we are all on our knees and seeking God for a move. You see, something else I love about Elijah is that it says he prayed seven times. Prayed seven times. He didn't just pray once or twice or three times, seven times. You know, seven is an incredible number. It's everywhere when you think about it. It's such an amazing number. We have seven colors in the rainbow. There are seven continents on this planet. There are seven wonders of the world. There are seven musical notes on the musical scale. There are seven days in the week. There are seven stages of grief. Seven is everywhere when we pay attention to it, including the Bible. From Genesis to Revelation, there are 700 references of the number seven. Number seven is important. I mean, you see how the Israelites, what do? They marched around the city of Jericho seven times. Naaman, he was told to go and wash in the Jordan River seven times before he was healed of leprosy. See, seven speaks of completeness. It speaks of full, of totality. And that's exactly why the number seven is so important in the Bible. Perhaps one of my favorite examples of the number seven in the Bible, it comes from the Gospel of John. When Jesus makes seven references to talk about who he is, there are seven times where he says, "I am," and then he described himself in some type of fashion. And I love that, where we don't have to go around saying, "Who is God? Who is Jesus? I don't know." Jesus is saying, "Hey guys, I'm over here. Let me tell you who I am in this season." And that's what I want to do today. I want to start off by focusing on the I am. And then we'll wrap up today by focusing on, am I though? I am I? So the first thing that Jesus said about himself comes from John chapter 6, where he says, I am the bread of life. Now, many of us, we're familiar with that statement, but let me give you a little bit of a backstory here of what was going on. You see, Jesus' popularity was through the roof. People were flocking to him because he was the miracle worker. He was doing all these great signs and wonders. He was speaking these amazing sermons, and people were coming to hear more. Well, on this one particular day, all these people were around, 5,000 men, so maybe 20,000 people in total. And it was getting late in the evening, people are getting hungry, and the disciples are saying, hey, Jesus, we need to send these people out into the towns to get something to eat. And I love what Jesus says to him. He says, you feed them. And the disciples are like, you kidding me? How are we going to feed 20,000 people? We don't have enough food for 20,000 people. And I love Jesus' response. He says, well, what do you have? And maybe this is a sermon for another day, church, but so often in life, we are looking at what other people have. But Jesus isn't asking what other people have. He's saying, but what do you have? What has God placed in your life? What are you supposed to be using in your life to bring glory to his name? And so that's what they said. Well, what do we have? We have a little lunchbox from a kid. We have 5 loaves and 2 fish. And you know how the story goes. Jesus gathers all the people. He puts them in little groups. He blesses the food. And then he distributes the food to all these people. And they eat their fill. And then afterwards, they collect all these buckets of leftovers. And that was speaking to me something else. You know, in every move of God, God will provide all that you need to get through that season. But he doesn't just stop there. He will also give you leftovers for the season to come. See, right now, with all the panic going on, some of us need to go back to the fridge. We need to look in our doggy bags. We need to look in our to-go boxes. And we need to remember who God is from the last move of God that we saw. Right now, we need to have hope in him, unlike any other time that we've had, and as we are in preparation for the next move of God to come. He's already moving right now. And so the story continues, and they feed everybody, and that night ends, and Jesus and his disciples go to the other side of the lake. Now, TMZ must have been reporting that morning, because they told everybody, hey guys, he's over there, so they all flocked to him again. But Jesus knew their hearts. He knew what was going on in them. They were seeking the miracle. They weren't seeking the miracle worker. They were looking for some breakfast that morning. They weren't seeking Jesus himself. And he makes this incredible statement in John 6, verse 35, where he says this. He says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall not thirst. You know, when we're hungry, we have a tendency to get angry. But whenever we're full, whenever we've had our fill, we're usually happy. And what Jesus is saying, he says, I am your fulfillment. I am your happiness. I am your joy. I am the bread of life. I will nourish you all you need. I will satisfy your soul completely. I am the bread of life. You know, the second I am statement that Jesus made is he says, I am the light of the world. This is what he says in John 8:12, where he says, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Do you feel like sometimes you're just stumbling around the darkness? Like, what is the meaning of my life? What is the purpose of all this stuff? What is the point of this moment that we're in? And what I love about those questions is those aren't questions that just I have or you have. Those are questions that everyone has. What is the meaning of my life? Why am I here? Where am I going when I'm dying? Why do I feel guilty every time I do something wrong? See, we're stumbling around in the darkness. And what Jesus is saying, he says, I am the light. I'm the light of the world, to where you no longer have to stumble around in darkness. Okay, you can find your purpose in me. You can find your meaning of life in me. You can find the point of everything that's going on around us right now. You can find that in me. I am the light of life. I love that. He is the light of the world. He says, I'm the bread of life. I am the light of the world. And the third I am statement that he makes, he says, I am the good shepherd. We see this in John chapter 10 and verse 11. He says, I am the good shepherd. But he doesn't just say shepherd. He says good shepherd. And the reason why is he says, because the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He says, look, a normal shepherd, yes, they will protect you, but I go above and beyond that. I actually lay my life down for you. I am the one that leads you beside still waters. I am the one that helps you to lie down in green pastures. I am the one that will guide you through the valley of the shadow of death. I am the one that is protecting you. I am the comforter of your soul. I am the good shepherd of your soul. And then he says, I am the door. You see this in John 10, verse 7, where he says this, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep." In verse 9, he says, "I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief only comes to steal, kill, and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it to the fullest." See what Jesus is saying here. He says, "I'm not just the shepherd for you, I'm also the door." And what shepherds would do in that time is they would lay down in the opening of the pen to where the sheep could go, come and go between them. And Jesus is saying, "I am the one that is laying between the bad and the good. I am the one that you can go through me to go in and out of the pasture." You see, the enemy only comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I came so that you could have life to the abundance. And I am the door to get there. The next "I am" statement that Jesus made was he said, "I am," and we all know this, "the way, the truth, and the life." We get this from John 14, 6, and he says, "No one has access to the Father. No one comes to the Father except through me." So often this is seen as a controversial verse. People, they look at this and they say, "Oh, this Jesus is being a mean person here." But he's like, no, Jesus is saying, "Who am I? Who am I? I am the way to get to God." Whether you believe it or not, there is this massive gap between you and God, me and God. There's an ocean of gap between us. And what Jesus is saying, he says, "I am the bridge that can now connect us together. I am the way to get to God." And that's why he says in John 14, 14, where he says, "If you ask anything in my name, it will be given to you." Why? Because I have access to the Father, and through me, you have access as well. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I'm the good shepherd. I'm the door. I am the way. I'm the bridge to this life. And then the sixth statement he makes about himself, he says, "I am the true vine." We get this from John 15, 1. He says, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser." And just like, you know, I'm not a gardener or anything. I really don't know anything about gardening. But one thing I do know, and most of us probably understand this, is that if you take apart a fruit from the vine, that fruit is not going to live by itself for very long. It may sustain life for maybe a couple of days, a few days, but eventually it's going to die. And that's what Jesus is saying here. He says, if you are connected to me, you will have life. But if you are disconnected from me, you cannot have life. And that's what God is looking for. That's what Jesus is looking for. He's not looking for an on-again, off-again relationship. He is looking for a life-giving relationship with you, and you have access to that. He is the true vine. And then the last statement that Jesus made about himself comes from John chapter 11. I'm going to give you a little backstory on this as we camp out on this for a little bit. See, one of Jesus' friends, Lazarus, has just passed away. You know, he's not in the ICU anymore. He's not on his deathbed. He didn't just pass away. No, the funeral casseroles have been expired. There's no more food left. He's been dead for 4 days. And then Jesus shows up on the scene. And you have his sisters, Lazarus's sisters, Mary and Martha. Mary stays behind as she cries, and Martha runs ahead to meet Jesus. She has all these things to say to him, like, "Where were you? Why were you not here sooner? If you were here, my brother would still be alive." And Jesus kind of questions her, and he says, "Don't you know that he's going to rise again?" And she says, "Yeah, I know he's going to rise when the resurrection comes." And then Jesus makes this incredible statement to her in John 11, verse 25, where he says, "Martha, I am the resurrection and the life." He says, "Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die." Do you believe this? Do you believe this? I mean, this is a total game-changing "I am" statement right here. Do you get that? This is why Paul in Philippians 4:4 is saying, "Rejoice in the Lord always." Again, I say rejoice. Why? Because he's the resurrection and the life. And because he's the resurrection, that means I too have a resurrection to come. I too, my name is written in the book of life because of what he's done. That's why Paul in Philippians 4:6 says, "Don't be anxious about anything, including the coronaviruses." Jesus, his "I am" statements, including this one that says, "I am the resurrection and the life," should completely change your mindset from here on out. You know, that's why Paul was saying, because I believe in the resurrection, because I believe in what he did, that means that I'm going to rise from the grave one day. And that completely, radically changes my mindset from here on out. I don't know if any of you have ever seen the Transformer movies. Probably most of you have. And I'm usually late to the scene when it comes to watching movies. I don't like waiting 3 years for the next one to come out. I let them all come out and then I'll watch them. And that's what the case was with the Transformer movies. Well, I was watching it recently, and if you don't know anything about them, here's a high level. There are two robots, okay? You have the good guys and the bad guys, the Autobots and the Decepticons. And the leader of the good guys is a guy named Optimus, or a robot named Optimus Prime. Okay, he's this amazing person. You look up to him. His leadership is impeccable. All the people, all their hope is in this Optimus Prime. Well, in the third movie, it seems like the Autobots, the good guys, their hands are behind their backs. And they're being forced off the planet. So they're all crammed into the spaceship and they're launched into space. Now, as they're flying up, a bad guy comes and shoots them down with a missile. And you see the debris of the spaceship falling back down into Earth's atmosphere, incinerating on the way down. And you're almost kind of in despair at that moment. Like, my heart's pounding. The music is epic because something dramatic is happening. All the characters in the movie are crying. And it's like, you're beginning to get overwhelmed. And in the middle of all this, in the middle of the chaos, I had to almost stop and say, wait a minute. This is just movie 3. There's movies 4, 5, and 6. They're still called Transformers, and Optimus Prime is still the face on all of it. He's the main character. They can't have Transformers without Optimus. And so anytime throughout the movie now, anytime I watch the movie, it's like, okay, look, I know that Optimus doesn't die. Yes, his back may be against the wall, and they may be making it seem like he's going to be defeated, but he doesn't die. He's the main character. But guys, that's what the resurrection of Jesus Christ should do to us. Look, I am just like you. I get into life sometimes. Situations arise. Things begin to spiral out of control. In those moments, I have to be careful to not panic. I have to step back and say, wait a minute. I don't really die in the end. It doesn't really matter what happens to me. It doesn't matter the circumstances that come my way. It doesn't matter the coronavirus is out there creeping in, because I know how this ends. I'm going to be okay. I will not die in the end. That's an amazing truth, that in any moment, guys, we will be with God in heaven forever. For movie 5, for movie 6, for movie 10 million, for movie 100 billion, and on and on and on. I mean, isn't that an amazing thought? That regardless of what comes our way, we can step back and say, you know what? It's all going to be okay in the end. I'm reminded of that quote from Billy Graham, where he says, look, I've read the last page of the Bible. It's all going to work out okay. And just like in this, our whole perspective of life changes because of what Jesus did by declaring that he is the resurrection and the life. So our death is no longer something that worries us or weighs us down anymore, because we have the victory in Christ. That's why Paul in 1 Corinthians 15:55, where he makes a statement about death, where he says, where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? It's like he's mocking death here, where he's saying, look, you know that Jesus died, right? And then he rose again. So what are we afraid about? He has removed the stinger from death. Death is not something to worry about. The sting is gone. What are some things that have stingers in life? Bees have stingers, and bees can be scary things, right? Sometimes we hate bees. We don't want to go anywhere around bees because they could sting us. It hurts. Some of us are allergic to bees, so we panic. We scream like little girls whenever the bees come around us. Bees can be a scary thing, but what if you remove the stinger from a bee? Then it's just this cute little fuzzy thing that flies off, and it's like, oh, that's so cute. And that's what death is like now. We no longer have to fear death because the stinger has been removed based on what Christ has done. So we no longer have to live in fear. In fact, that's when Romans 8 becomes more clear to us, that even in death, we are more than conquerors. Death is no longer lording itself over us, but now it is serving us for the glory of God, because it can actually bring us closer to him in the long run. Death is not something that we should worry about, all because of one man rising from the grave, all because the I Am showed us who he is. And so now that we know the I Am, now comes the question, am I? Or even before we get to the question, am I, The question, do I? You know, usually whenever I do funerals, I always ask this question, and it may seem a little weird and obvious what the answer is, but it's, do you want to go to heaven? Do I really want to go to heaven? Now, the cliche answer is, of course I want to go to heaven, but think about that for a second. With what you understand heaven to be like in your mind, do you want to go there? I used to be told when I was a kid that heaven was a place with your favorite food. You would just go around and you could enjoy all the favorite foods that you love. And so as a kid, I always thought that heaven was just a place with nachos and cheese and pizza. Not Supreme pizza, that's disgusting. I'm talking about like pepperoni pizza. So all day long, I was just going to eat nachos and cheese and pizza. But look, I'm no health expert, but I know that my body could not survive on that many carbs for that long. I would be overweight very quickly. So heaven has to be more than just my favorite foods. Sometimes I always hear that, you know, heaven's a place where we will be with all the loved ones we have. And that may be true. I don't disagree with that. And that's going to be a great time. But have you ever been to a family reunion? It's cool for like an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours tops. And then you're like, I've got to get away. I've got to go back home. Heaven has to be more than just a family reunion. Well, maybe it's when all the church will come together and we'll sing together. You know, there's that famous line in Amazing Grace where it says, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun. I always look at that and it used to scare me as a kid. It's like, I don't like hanging out with church people for an hour on Sunday sometimes, much less 10,000 years. You kidding me? Heaven has to be more than just one giant church service for 10,000 years. Some people say, well, look, heaven is, we'll be up in the clouds, we'll be flying around and having a great time. Look, human flight has been a lifelong goal of mine, okay? I have failed miserably trying to achieve this goal my whole life, okay? But despite that being cool, that too, there has to be something more. In this day and age, we get so fed up with things so quick, right? Things don't matter to us after 3-4 weeks, and then we move on to the next thing. So human flight, while cool, heaven has to be more. And then I think about the creation of God. You know, heaven is described as a paradise. Paradise. You know, just that word seems nice, doesn't it? And I don't know if you've ever been on vacation before where you look out and you're like, man, this is a paradise out here. Maybe it's the beach when you dig your toes into the sand, you breathe in that fresh ocean air. There's no tourist around. It's just you. And maybe you dip into the cool water, whatever it may be, and you're like, man, this is a paradise. I know for me, one of my favorite places that I've ever been was to Jackson, Wyoming, when I went to see the Teton Mountains. If you've never been to the Tetons, I always tell people, close your eyes, imagine what you think mountains should look like, and you just picture the Teton Mountains. And I remember just sitting out on that crystal lake, that crystal clear lake, and just looking up at this magnificent mountain range and just worshiping God as a result. You see, that's what creation does. But what blows my mind about all this is that God created everything that we see, the heavens, the earth, all that. He created in 6 days. And we're blown away. We are led to worship by looking at the creation of God. But Jesus says, I am going away to prepare a place for you. Now, that was 2,000 years ago. So I can just hear God saying, look, are you blown away by 6 days of my creation? What do you think I'm going to do with 720,000 days under my belt? See, do you want to go to heaven? You better believe that you want to go to heaven. That's why Paul said in 1 Corinthians 2:9, he says this, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the heart of a man imagined, what God has prepared for those who love him. Do we want to go to heaven? Yes, we want to go to heaven. So now we answer the question, do I? Now the question is, am I? So often when I talk to people about, are you going to heaven or not? It's always met with, yeah, I think so. Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Yeah, I think I'm going to go to heaven. And that blows my mind. That trips me out. And the reason why is because people are willing to risk an eternity of heaven or hell on an I think so. Isn't that crazy? And usually when I say, well, why are you going to heaven? They say, because I'm a pretty good person. I'm a pretty good person. I've done some good things in my life. It's like, well, okay, let's just start to do the math on this. Just if you've only done maybe 10 bad things in your life on average, okay, like maybe I've had only 10 negative thoughts, or maybe kind of had a little bit of anger to someone, I woke up on the wrong side of the bed, I maybe didn't show as much love as I needed to, just 10 a day. If you're 30 years old, that means you've committed over 100,000 offenses. It doesn't matter if you go to the most corrupt judge on the planet, they're going to throw the book at you. You see, none of us are worthy based on what we've done. Our bad far outweighs our good. See, the Bible says in Romans 3:23 that all have sinned and fallen short of God's glorious standard. We've all sinned. There's no way that we could swim across that gap of ocean. We need a bridge. You know, I don't know if you have kids, but I have two of them. And I was talking about my three-year-old earlier, but I want to talk about my one-year-old for a second. I love this girl. She's just so sweet, and she's in that stage right now where she's becoming a daddy's girl. I love it. I mean, it kind of sucks for my wife, but I mean, I love that she is just in love with me. And so she will bury her head into my neck, and I'll just hold her tight, and she just doesn't want me to let her go. Like today, I went home just to see her for a little bit, and she's laying down, and she leans over and she gives me a kiss, and I'm like, hey, Rosie, I love you. And then she leans back over and gives me another kiss. She did this like 3 or 4 times. I mean, melted my heart. I mean, I can hold this girl for hours. And that's what God feels for us. Where he's like, look, I just want to hold you. I want you to know that I'll nourish you. I'll give you whatever you need. I am the bread of your life. He says, I'm the light of your world. I will guide you in the directions you need to have. Just seek me first. Follow my light, and I will guide you where you need to go. I'm your good shepherd. I'm your protector. I'm the door for you. I'm the vine. I am the way. I'm the bridge for you. I love that. But here's the thing, is we understand the love of God to a degree, but we don't fully comprehend the love of God. And what do I mean by that? Is as much as I love my daughter, I'm not going to put her on a cross. And despite how much I may love you, church, I'm not going to have her die for you. Whether you're good or you're bad, I'm not going to have her die for you. And what God is saying is, but I love you that much. I love you that much that I am willing to take my precious son and put him on a cross and have him suffer so that if you believe in him, if you believe that he is the resurrection and the life, that you'll never perish, but you too will be resurrected and your name will be written in the book of life. That is the gospel. And that is how crazy God is for you. That he was willing to look at his son in the garden praying, Dad, is there any other way? Is there any other way for this to happen? And him saying, son, I love them that much that you're going to actually have to pay the penalty for all of their sins. But son, here's the beauty, is if they believe in you as a result, they'll have life with us. It's a beautiful, beautiful story. You know, I'm reminded of a quote by Martin Luther when he says, there are 2 days in my calendar. This day and that day. That day meaning when we get to see God. And what's amazing about that, what's funny, is that what happens this day determines what happens that day. And if that day is true, what are we doing this day to see if we're really ready for it? So my question for you today, church, is this. Are you ready to be with God? Are you really ready to be with him? You know, I know right now, in the midst of everything that we're in, we're tired, we're fatigued, we're just beat. But what God says is that I will take your soul and make it fully alive. You know why? Because I am the bread of life. Because I am the light to give you meaning and purpose in life. Because I am the good shepherd, I am going to comfort you and protect you from all the things. I am the door. Through me is how you enter in to the pasture. I am the way. I am the bridge between you and God. I am the true vine. I am looking for this connectedness that you will have life through it. And I am the resurrection and the life. Do you believe this? Or better yet, did you know that God is real? Hey church, I really hope you enjoyed today's service. We serve a risen King who said, I am the bread of life, I am the light of the world, I am the good shepherd, I am the door, I am the way, the truth, and the life, I am the true vine, and I am the resurrection and the life. You know, that story in John chapter 11 with Jesus' friend Lazarus dying, we can relate to a lot of the characters in that story. Some of us, we might relate to Martha in a season like this. Like, God, where are you? Why are you waiting so long to move? If you would have showed up earlier, none of this would have happened. Why are you not present right now? Some of us, we can relate to Mary. To be honest, we're just sad. It's a sad time. We're seeing everybody in fear. It's like, God, yes, I love my church. Yes, I read the word, but God, I just need you right now. It's just a sad moment. And I think many of us, we can relate to Lazarus, that there's just deadness in our life. And maybe some of us, we're spiritually dead. You know, church isn't going to stir up the deadness. You can't wake up from deadness. You can't move around from deadness. Reading your Bible might not necessarily wake up your deadness. The only thing that can bring deadness to life is Jesus Christ. And if you don't know who Jesus is, today is that day that you too can run out of the grave, that you too can rise again just like Christ has risen. And so many Christians around the world have as well. Look, church, I love you. And if I'm honest, I miss you right now. It's hard being in this beautiful chapel all by ourselves. You know, I mean, you're nowhere to be around. It's just me and really Hunter here. And it's lonely. But right now is the time where we have to trust in God even more, where our hope needs to be firmly planted in him, where we have to be rooted. I mean, isn't that funny that the vision of this year was rooted? And right now, our roots are digging deep, not in our fellowship. Our roots are not digging deep in a building. Our roots are digging deep in the glory and greatness of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Church, I love you, and I'll see you soon.